out and a lot of traveling going on, so it's like we got a good crowd for a break week, a really good crowd for a break week. We're going to try it all again. Everybody with a little enthusiasm, good morning. If you're like me, I want to know if anybody got up an hour early this morning because your alarm clock automatically sets itself for daylight savings time. Suzanne just looked at Joe and said, that's what happened. I wanted to get to church early this morning, so I set the clock to get up at 6:30. It went off at 5:30 and I got up. I was the first one here today. It was dark and I thought the Lord's come and I'm the... And Jill said, go on if you're going that early. But anyway. Two or three announcements to go over. If you'll turn and just look at them in your bulletin, there's a lot there, but let me bring your attention to a couple. Easter lilies, if you want to do one in honor or memory of someone, it tells you how to do that. Also, Easter morning breakfast. Next week, our Sunday school classes will meet, our adult classes, just for a few moments to do the roll and offerings and things like that they do, and then come to the fellowship hall at 9:45, and we're going to have bagels and donuts and coffee and milk and orange juice and things like that just for a light breakfast on Easter morning between the services, so everybody can be together for a few minutes. And also, I know on Easter, a lot, maybe have some family will be in town or some be coming to church, get back in here a little bit earlier maybe and get a seat and meet them and be able to sit with them. We expect, obviously, a big crowd. We don't know what, but last year there were 970-some here for Easter, so we expect a big crowd and important to get here. So remember that. No evening service on Easter. The special interest classes, I want to mention those again. If you still want to come, we had a good number of people here for photography, one for knitting and one for crocheting this past Thursday night. Those are going 3 or 4 weeks, and then we're going to do some different classes on jewelry, sewing, and different things just so people can learn and be a part of hobbies and things that are really just good in our lives. So pay attention to that. I'm working in the works now. I don't want to put the pressure on anybody, but I'm hoping my nephew, Matt Clark, who is a chef, will do one a few nights on cooking. Not to put any pressure on him in front of a crowd, but I thought I'd mention that and call him by name. So anyway, those are going on. The others, just take the time to read them. I would want you to know today, if you've got everybody's attention, to let you know that the flowers up here this morning are in honor of a couple of babies that have been born in the church, Scott and Deanna Barnett, with the baby boy. They're not able to be here today. His name is Bryson Chase. And the Brins, I think, are here. Taylor Reese. Dad, are you here? Is he in here? If you all want to come up, and we'll let you introduce Taylor Reese. This is Kevin and Tracy Brin, who worship with us. Born the 23rd, and we're going to see how good Dad is at the length and the weight and all of those important things.
She was born the 23rd. She was 8 pounds, 10 ounces, 21 and a quarter inches long. And again, her name is Taylor Reese.
Congratulations.
Thanks, sir.
Let's have prayer together for them. Father God, thank you for Kevin and Tracy. Thank you for their love for you and a child, Father, being born into a home where there is faith and belief. Father, we pray that you be with Taylor, that you bless her in her development and in her growth. That, Father, in everything that's done and said, that above anything in the world that happens, she'll know that God loves her very deeply. Father, we thank you for both the children who have been born and the parents, and we just pray your blessing and your love upon them in ways that we cannot even begin to understand, that as the apostle said, they know a peace beyond understanding. Be with them as young parents, Father. We pray as a church, and we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations. It's with sadness, and we see the whole cycle of life, don't we? Sue Overbay, who has been a member of this church for so many, many years, passed away Friday evening late, and I want to send our friend or our love and our condolences to her family and friends that are here this morning. There's nieces and nephews that are here, and to let everyone know that the family will be receiving friends tomorrow from noon to 1 here at the church, and then her funeral will be at 1 o'clock and her burial both tomorrow. She'll be buried in the cemetery here at the church. So we want to remember Sue Overbay and her family, nieces and nephews that are here especially at this time. Let's all stand. We'll go to God in prayer. And as always, we'll close that prayer with a pledge and a prayer together. It's printed in your bulletin or be in the screen this morning. Let's bow our heads. Father, please bless us with your presence and your kindness and your spirit this morning. Father, we count it a joy that we can come and we can worship. We count it an honor, Father, that we can be in a place with those of like faith and like belief. Father, we'll look at Scripture this morning that's very sobering about our lives. We'll look at all that Jesus did to validate that Scripture and to prove it true. And Father, we just ask that you'll open hearts and minds to praise, that you'll allow us a time around your table that is full of awe and full of reverence for what Jesus has done, and that, Father, when we look at your word, that it will challenge us to change, that we leave different than when we came as Christians. Father, we pray together at this time as a statement of hope and worship, and please join me. From this moment on, it's not about me, but it's all about Jesus. And all of God's people say it. Amen.
God is worthy to receive honor and glory and praise, and he's worthy to see to receive all our love. So let's share our love with one another as we greet each other.
Thank you. fresh out.
Much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.
King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Every single breath,
I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'll bring you more than a song. I'll bring you more than a song, for it's all about you, Jesus. I'll bring you more than a song. I'll bring you more than a song, for it's all about you, Jesus.
Please be seated. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 18. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. As we prepare to come to the Lord's table, we remember the cross and the suffering Christ endured to pay sin's price.
Your only Son, no sin too high.
but you have sent him from your side to walk upon this guilty side and to become the Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. Your gift of love they crucified. They laughed and scorned him as he died. The humble king they named a frog and Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. But you have brought me to your side to be led by your staff and rod and to be called a Lamb of God. Oh, Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the holy Lamb of God. Oh, wash me in his precious blood till I am just a Lamb of
God. We've come into the house today, I'd like everyone just to think of what this week means to you. This week marks the time we remember Jesus as he entered Jerusalem to die for mankind. The time was a time he chose, and the time was one that God in all his wisdom understood to be right. Many things we will not understand until the time we eat of a meal in heaven with Christ. The Lord's table, especially this week, reminds us that his death has not brought peace on earth, because we have wars and numerous of wars and different turmoil going on at all times. There is a division and hatred throughout the world, and sometimes even among the Christians. Many people do not even claim a faith in Christ, and for many, the faith is weak and not very deep. There are several scriptures in the Bible that we things of the Lord's Supper and different things that he has done different meetings that he had with different ones. I would like to read the one in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 11, 27. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. This is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. This coming week is a week described as a week of passion, the week of Christ's death, and I would ask all of you who are here to take very seriously, remembering him on this day will not be toward saving those, forgiving them the rest of the week. If you thought of him today and that's it, then you may need to think of him the rest of the week rather than just one day. The next few minutes we remember and recount our lives to obedience of Christ. We should be warned and are warned that from Scripture that all who handle his body in a manner of disrespect eat and drink damnation unto themselves. I wish to ask you today to join us, and we grasp the seriousness of the time, the nature of the death, and the respect it depends as we partake of his body and blood.
Almighty God, we recognize this morning that you created us to commune with you. But Father, even from that beginning, and even now, Father, we are separated from you by sin. And Father, our hope this morning, the only hope that we have, is that we can be reconciled back to you through the sacrifice of the perfect Lamb of God, Jesus Christ. And so this morning, Father, as we partake of the body and blood of the sacrificed Lamb of God, Father, clear our minds of all other thoughts. Father, may we be mindful only and humbled by the fact, Father, that we are sinners saved by grace, returned to you only, Father, by the Son and the Christ, Jesus. Father, bless us as we, your church, come together in unison and partake of this body and blood. May we be blessed for it. Father, use us in your service. Set us apart as your hands and feet and voices. And Father, this morning, though, humble us. Thank you this morning for the warning in the Scripture that we may be humbled during this time of communion. Thank you for Jesus, Father, in whose name we pray. Amen.
As Jesus met in the upper room with the disciples, he said, "Take, eat, this is my body." Also the cup, he said, "This is my shed blood. Do this in remembrance of me."
It's a hymn, it's a song, it's not a verse of scripture, but the question is asked, what can wash away my sins? And the answer is given, nothing but the blood of Jesus. That statement, although written by man, is one of the most profound ever stated. It is one of the most divisive ever heard. It is one of the most contemplative that has ever been offered, and is one of the most controversial that will ever be examined. I want you to listen to the words of the apostle to the letter to the church at Corinth found in 1 Corinthians 1, verse 18. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, those who do not believe. And the message of the cross to those who are being saved, those who believe, is the power of God. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. We come together on a day on our calendar that's known as Palm Sunday. It was a day that Jesus had said he would enter to Jerusalem. He entered Jerusalem and the crowds came out to welcome him. It was a false worship they offered, and Jesus understood that. So many of them, so very many of them, understood that he was coming as an earthly king. And he knew it was different. He knew he was coming that he might die for our sins. And I want you to listen to the words of Jesus and what he says about blood, not just his, but the blood of those who are righteous that have come before him, that have been killed because of their stands of faith. He says to those in Jerusalem, "You snakes, you brood of vipers, how will you escape being condemned to hell? Therefore I'm sending you prophets, and I'm sending you wise men and teachers. And some of them you will kill and crucify. Others you will flog in your synagogues, and you will pursue them from town to town. And so upon you will come all the righteous blood that has been shed on earth, from the blood of righteous Abel to the blood of Zechariah, whom you murdered between the temple and the altar. I tell you the truth, all of this will come upon this generation." And then he says to the people who are there, and I hope we will listen with kindred ears, "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together as a mother hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing." I want us to enter this week that we call the Passion Week, this week that is an Easter week. We will celebrate Resurrection Sunday next week as the seeds of a church that will enter the week very sober and very somber for what is to come. We'll celebrate this coming Friday night, a night of darkness in which we'll acknowledge the death of Christ because of our sins. And we'll come together on Sunday to celebrate the story of the resurrection and the fact of eternal life that that offered. But I want you to understand today that what you saw in that video of blood and what we've read of blood and what we think of as our sins being washed away with blood, that blood of Christ divides the world into two very different corners. Ephesians, the sixth chapter, tells us that we do not do battle or wrestle with flesh and blood, but with the forces of evil that lives and abides in the heavenly realms. Both sides of the great divide are very evangelistic. They want to win others over to their side, for one is under the command of Satan, and one is under the command of Jesus as the Son of God. His blood is what makes the difference. So the world is divided. Every man, every woman, every person standing on one or other side of that great divide, standing in one or the other corner. Both sides have very learned and intelligent people, and also the uneducated in their corner. Both have scientists in their corner that will debate and argue with one another, and both sound very reasonable if you sit and listen to them, but you must decide. Both have wealth in their corner. There are great amounts of money spent in order to destroy the message of Christ. And there are great amounts of money spent in order to spread the love of Christ. Both worlds require faith. You must believe one way or the other. And Jesus, in speaking of this faith, said very simply, "I want you on one side or the other, and if you stand in the midst, you're lukewarm, and I will vomit you out of my mouth." He has no place in his kingdom for those that would straddle a fence. He sees them either 100% for him or 100% against him, and that's how every one of us will be viewed in judgment. The two divisions created by the blood cross national lines and cultural lines, so that I have more in common with a man named Abraham in southern India than I do a non-believer who lives in the same neighborhood with me. He is my brother in Christ. He will be my brother for all eternity. But there's one thing for sure. There is a radical difference in the two sides, believers and non-believers. And that difference is so radical that the two cannot coexist and will not coexist beyond this earth's winding clock, where Jesus says there will be strife and division. I'm going to ask you, if you would, to jot down a handful of things today. This sermon is just a list of bullets. We're going to look at a lot of scripture as we near the end. But I want us to see some things that the gospel demands, the gospel boldly states. I'm going to give you seven of them, just as one line or just a few words that you can jot down in your Bibles or on the notes there in your bulletin. The gospel declares boldly. The gospel declares boldly. And you'll understand the gospel and its simplicity with what it declares. The gospel declares boldly. Number one, that the heavens and the earth were placed into existence by God. It did not just happen, but God placed them into existence. The scripture declares very early on in the assumption of God that in the beginnings God created the heavens and the earth. So the gospel declares that the heavens and the earth were placed into existence by God. The gospel declares, number two, that man broke relationship with God when we chose to sin. Man broke relationship with God when we chose to sin. That relationship was whole, that relationship was pure. We were made in His image, and we chose to sin and broke that relationship. Number three, God's purity demands death for sin. God cannot coexist with sin, will not allow it in His presence, and demands that sin be eradicated, and that can only be done in death. God's purity, not His hatred, but His purity demands death for sin. Number four, God is a God of love, and His love made sacrifice for my sin. Being true to His nature and demanding death for sin, His love also said He would provide the sacrifice or the death for my sin and yours. God's love made sacrifice for my sin. Number five, the gospel boldly states that Christ was God's Son, and it was He who paid the price. Christ was God incarnate living among us, the Son of the living God who spoke the world into existence, and He paid the price. Christ was God's Son. Number six, the gospel boldly declares that Christ arose on the third day. That validated every claim of the gospel before and since, that Christ arose on the third day. We celebrate that, not one day a year. Maybe the world does, maybe our culture does. But we celebrate every time we come around the Lord's table, for the scripture boldly states that we show His death until He comes again when we gather to partake of the body and the blood of Christ. The gospel declares boldly that Christ arose on the third day. Number seven, the gospel declares boldly that God's love demands repentance of sinful man. Christ's death was not enough. But just as we chose to sin, we can choose to turn our backs on sin so that we are new people, willing and able to accept Christ as a Savior. There must be repentance. And if there is no repentance, there can be no salvation. Evil cannot exist, and evil cannot expect to reside in the purity of a new earth and a new Jerusalem that we call heaven without repentance. There must be repentance. Now, the world does not believe that. Remember what we read in 1 Corinthians. It's foolishness. That whole message, everything I just said, is foolishness to those that are perishing. There will be people come into this building and sit through worship service that will hear all of that is foolishness. That's not what it really means. We'll rationalize all sorts of sin in people's lives. We'll rationalize all sorts of sin in our own lives. We will make it foolishness. This is the thinking of the world where it is foolishness. I'll give you four or five real brief. The world that does not believe and sees the cross as foolishness will have several thoughts. First one is there is no God. Some may believe that, or at least wonder. And so they will not sell out to a God they're not sure about. There is no God. And there's a whole lot of things we can do in the foolishness. Maybe we believe there is no God, or we'll believe, number two, that a loving God could not despise sin. God doesn't hate sin. How could a loving God ever send someone to hell? And a lot of people will go to hell arguing that very thing. Well, a loving God doesn't send anyone to hell. A loving God sends His Son to die for our sins, if we'll accept it. If we'll accept it. Or, number three, a person who says the cross is foolishness will say something like, God can't be proved, so I won't believe. I need proof, so I'm not going to believe at all. And we hear that argued quite often today in various circles. Or, those who believe it's foolishness may say, Christians are a backward people. They're stuck in the dark ages. One minister tells the story of meeting with a city councilman. The church is very large, and they were trying to pass an ordinance that he did not feel went with the stand of the scripture, and city councilman knew he didn't. Some of you have heard this story maybe, and as he went, Bob Russell's his name, a church of 20,000 plus people at the time, and as he went to meet the city councilman, he said, why do you not accept this? And he read some scripture that called what they were wanting to do a sin. And the city councilman's response to him in Louisville, Kentucky was, have you never had an original thought? Or in other words, you're backwards. Maybe it was a sin in the 1950s, but my goodness, this is the 2000s. Christians are backward, some believe. Others would say Christians are evil, or God is evil. And we'll begin to attribute the things of Satan to God. So the question becomes, which side of the great divide are you all on? You have to decide individually. It all comes down to this. Nothing can take away the results of man's sin but the blood of Christ. That is the dividing statement. Nothing can take away man's sin but the blood of Christ. I accept that fact. Do you accept it? If you accept it, then these are things we believe, that no other faith is equal to faith in Christ. Jesus said, I am the way to the Father. There is no way to the Father but by me. Any man who's seen me has seen the Father. That's said of no one else. I believe that no amount of hypocrisy upon the part of believers negates the facts of Christianity. We're all hypocrite at one time or another in our lives. That should be something we repent of, something we leave behind. But it doesn't matter how much hypocrisy there is. It doesn't matter how much evil you can sometimes see or hear in a church. That does not negate the fact of Christianity that sin sent Jesus to the cross and He rose on the third day. If we believe nothing can take away the result of man's sins but the blood of Christ, then we believe that the sin of yesterday is indeed the sin of today. We cannot rationalize it away and say it's a different culture or a different time, therefore adultery is okay, or lust is okay, or greed is okay, or any other number of sins. We believe that no man can judge another, but only Christ would judge. And I'll remind you again that we wrestle not with flesh and blood, but with the principalities and powers and the dark forces of evil in the heavenly realms. We don't judge other people. We accept the fact that nothing can take our sin away but blood. Then we accept the fact that death apart from Jesus is a precursor to eternal damnation. We accept the fact, and listen to this and you'll see what I mean, it's a sobering week, that I personally know people who are going to go to hell. That I personally know people that will be in hell. If nothing can take away the results of men's sin but the blood of Christ, then I accept that I'm going to stand before God, David Clark, alone, and be judged by Him. And we all will face that. Now, that's all a lie if there's no resurrection. Do you believe there was a resurrection? Ask yourself. Do you believe it? And if you do, then this sin has to be left behind. If you do, you've got to be not lukewarm but on fire for Christ, as so many of you are. If you do, there's tons of implications to what it means for us every day of our lives. Now, I want us to read some scripture, and I'm going to ask you to turn back to Luke. We're going to look at Luke, Matthew, and John. They're all there close together in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And I'm going to ask you to turn to Luke, and I want you to listen to these statements from Scripture that were validated by the death, burial, and resurrection. I'm going to ask everybody, please, I'm begging you, turn to these, read them with your own eyes, listen to them, allow the Word of God to work in your life right now. Luke 12, and we'll read verses 49 through 53. Sobering words from Jesus that when the grave was empty, these words became true. Now, while we're turning to these, I want you to think for a minute about the thoughts that people must have had when they heard the teachings of Jesus and thought, wow, that's powerful. That makes one think. That is something else. And then they'd watch the miracles and start to think, well, maybe that's true. Maybe what he's saying, he really knows. But when the grave was empty, there was no question left. Everything we can look back on now, we know is the truth because an empty grave proves it, right? So listen to this. Luke, the 12th chapter, verses 49 through 53. Jesus speaking. I've come to bring fire on the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. But first, I'm adding first, I have a baptism to undergo, and how distressed I am until it is completed. Do you think I came to bring peace on earth? No, I tell you, but division. From now on, there will be five in one family, divided against each other. Three against two, and two against three. I remember reading that as a child, and there was my mom, my dad, and my three brothers, the three of us. And I remember thinking, wow, I can say in joy now we're all Christian, and two have gone on before the other three of us as Christians. But that's powerful language when you think about a family, because I have family members that aren't Christian. They will be divided, father against son, and son against father, mother against daughter, and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. Jesus is not telling us to hate anyone, is he? But he says that great divide's there. And we'll find family in the family of God for those that see the power of the cross, and we'll find foolishness for those that do not. He validated that statement. Luke 13:5. There's many, many of these, and this just over into the next chapter. Luke 13:5. When he's talking about the importance of repentance, he says, I tell you no, and don't worry about the first of that, it refers back. But then he says, unless you repent, you will all perish. There is no salvation without repentance. He validated that. He validated that. We like to think that death itself gives us that ticket, but Jesus validated there must be repentance for this, a very sobering week for us. Matthew, the 19th chapter. Matthew 19. Talking to a man that did everything right. But he worshiped one thing, he held on to one thing, and that was his finances. He held on to that which made him powerful. And in Matthew, the 19th chapter, verse 20 and 21, when he was challenged by the commandments, he says, all these I've kept, the young man said, but what do I still lack? And Jesus answered, if you want to be perfect, go and sell your possessions and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and then come and follow me. Now, listen and listen close. Jesus wasn't addressing just money. Now, that's let everybody off the hook for a second. He was addressing anything that stood between us and doing what God would have us to do. The fact of the matter is, in American culture, for most of us, it's money. Most of us, it's money. I'm going to tell you one barometer of what I mean. How many in the last three or four days, or in the last week, have complained that gas prices have gone up? How many? Is there anybody that couldn't come this morning because gas prices went up? Is there anybody that will not go eat lunch this afternoon because gas prices went up? Because I'm going to tell you, for every one of us that had to buy a gallon of gas, there are people all over the world starving to death. What do we worship? And quite often it can be not only what you pay homage to, but what you complain about. And we've got to repent of that type of thing. We've got to turn our back on that type of thing. We've got to not just give God the gravy, but give him the whole plate of meal. And he told this rich young man, oh, you're doing it all right, but this one thing is keeping you from knowing the peace of God. It's your worship of money. And the question would become, when Jesus validated that in the resurrection, what are you worshiping? What are you putting between Christ and yourself? What one sin do you think I can hold on to it because all the others aren't a problem for me? John, the 6th chapter, the 53rd verse. Sobering scriptures. An empty grave validated. John 6, 53. Jesus is talking about he's the source of life, of true life, and likens himself unto bread. I don't think at all what he says here is lost on the Lord's table. Matter of fact, I like to see it as a bright spotlight on the Lord's table and what happens. But listen what he validates when he says in verse 53, Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Jesus declared, or the apostle declared, when we come around the table, we show his death until he comes again. This is of grave importance, what we do every week, because we recognize that this is our source of life. This is the very reason we exist, is the body and the blood of Christ. Jesus validated that. He validated that with his death, but he validated it with his resurrection. I want us to look at one other verse, John, the 6th chapter. And you can go through, and if you want to do an interesting study, just go through and read the Gospels and think, what did he validate? But John 6, reading verse 65, it says, Jesus went on to say, this is why I told you that no one can come to me unless the Father has enabled him. What's that mean? What's it mean to say the Father has enabled him? We could talk a long time about what it means. But one thing is for sure, I can't do it on my own. It's the power of God that's allowed any of us to be here this morning and hear the Word. It's not for us to take the Word and say, well, this is what I think, this is what I'll apply. But it is taking the facts of God's love for us and bending ourselves to those facts. That's repentance. God has enabled it to happen. And I want to read one last verse that he validated. This is a sober week. Very comforting scripture in the midst of all of those that challenge us. John 14, verses 1 through 4. There's the great divide. You answer which side you're on by your lifestyle and your statements of faith. John 14, 1 through 4, Jesus says to those who see the power of the cross, not the foolishness, but those who see the power of the cross, listen what he says. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. And I'm going there to prepare a place for you. Now I want to stop, and many of you know this, but allow me to just teach for a second here. In the Jewish culture, the backdrop against which Jesus was speaking, when a young man chose a bride and had proposed to her and everything had been worked out for the marriage, he then went back to his father's house and he started adding on, and the husband would take the bride to live in that home. His love for her, his wealth, would be a barometer. You know, he would do everything he could to make it as fine and as beautiful as humanly possible. And then when it was ready, they would go and the wedding would take place, and he would bring her back, and she would live there with him in that room built onto the house. So quite often these houses would get large if there were several sons there who had married. Against that backdrop and with that marriage language, Jesus says to us, "In my Father's house are many rooms. And if that wasn't true, I'd have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you." Jesus has been preparing a place for us for 2,000 plus years and continues to do so for those who see the power of the cross and really live it. He says in verse 3, "If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am." You know the way to the place where I'm going. I stood in this baptistry this morning with a 40 plus year old man who declared in obedience and repentance his faith in Jesus Christ as the Son of God. And he stood in the Baptist meeting with me this morning and wept and declared to me as that screen was going down, "This is the most exciting day of my life." He went back and got dressed and came out, and we hugged each other, and he said, "David, this is the most exciting day of my life. God is preparing a room for him." Now that's the promise, but we have to decide which side we stand on. Foolishness or the truth? Not the words we use, but it all comes down to the life we're living. James said, "Faith without works is dead." If you'll allow me to paraphrase, faith without lifestyle is dead. He even said, "You tell me or show me your faith, I'll show you my works. I'll show you my lifestyle as a barometer, do I really believe or not?" One is one of hope. One is one of encouragement. One is one of anticipation of the life to come. One is eternal life that's found in the blood of Christ. Finish the sentence for me. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Do you believe it? Do you believe it? We're going to sing this morning a hymn of invitation. If you were to react to that, it's radical. Some people might think you crazy. It's radical. But I want to challenge you, if there's a need to react to that today as an invitation, you would be asked, whatever the decision, to declare, "I believe Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God." If you're willing to come to Him in repentance, you're willing to declare that. You're willing to say, "I see it as the power of the cross, not as foolishness." I'll ask you to come this morning. We're going to stand and sing. Any decision, please come this morning. I want to add one thing this morning. Dick, come on up if you want to, but you look around. We've got a big crowd here this morning, so God will bless us. We only know or hope what next week Easter brings. If we're allowed that worship service, it's going to be a great day, so get here early and get a good seat. There's some of you that need to be in the front row, so I'll tell you as you go out the door, you need to be here. But we're looking forward to a lot of visitors. I want you to know all the parking is completed all around the building. Let people that are visiting, maybe hadn't heard the gospel in a while, we don't know how God will work, but allow them some of the good places to get here, because they will by nature come right at the beginning time, so allow that. It's just good to see everybody this morning, and I think that puts us in a mind of being vigilant and prayerful for our church and God's protection of our church, because as I've told you before, and I want to repeat today just from my heart, Satan hates what's happening here. He hates that people came this morning for service. He hates that a gentleman gave his life to Christ this morning in his 40s. He hates that. So let's just encourage and hope and pray and love each other as best we can on this side of heaven.
Our Lord God, David preached today about the great divide and about how Jesus is the only true life to be found. And we shared together with the Lord's table, sharing the body and the blood that includes us on your side of that great divide. So thank you for receiving our repentance as we willingly confess Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Hallelujah. Lord, save us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. You're dismissed.